So, you want to visit a haunted house, hmm? I think I have one that should suit you. That is, if you dare follow me. You will? Fine. Shall we go, then? Ah, here we are at the door. Happy haunting.
Why are we here?
I told Ralph I'd check this place out for the Halloween party. Come on.
Are you crazy? I'm not going in there. This is the Simpson house.
Oh, what are you scared of? Listen, you're a chipmunk, right? And chipmunks are never scared, right?
Wrong.
Then you'll be the only brave chipmunk. Come on.
I'm not going in there. Everyone knows about old Magnolia Simpson. Ever since she lost her head, anyone who goes in there gets theirs chopped off, too.
Now, where'd you hear that?
Phyllis Boyer. She told me about the four people who were in there last Halloween, and they never, ever came out.
They just disappeared, right?
Just their heads.
Well, if something like that would have happened, it would have been in all the newspapers.
Phyllis said that the ghost warned the reporters not to write about it.
That's just a story. Now, come on, I can't leave you out here alone, so come on in with me, all right?
If I get my head chopped off, Richie Cunningham, I'm gonna tell Mom on you.
Well, that's good. Cover your head. You'll be safe. See, it's just an old house with some cobwebs. Mrs. Simpson? She has a head? Joni,
I'm not losing my head for some Ralph Mouse party.
Anybody here?
Richie, what happened?
Oh, nothing, nothing. It's good. It's a good place for a party.
It looks like Bela Lugosi sucked all the blood out of
me. Oh, I do not. Come on, come on, let's go.
Am I gonna drive?
Will you quit fooling around? We gotta get home. I'm hungry.
You're gonna have a tough time eating with your heart in your mouth.
Ha ha ha, Joni. Ha ha ha. Very funny. You know, you ought to quit fooling around with that Phyllis.
Boy.
Yeah, right. Reporters.
The haunted house. Not a window was broken, and the paint wasn't peeling. Not a porch step sagged. Yet there was a feeling that beyond the door and into the hall, this was the house of no one at all. No one who breathed, nor laughed, nor ate, nor said I love, nor said I hate. Yet something walked along the stair, something that was and wasn't there. And that is why weeds on the path grow high, and even the moon races fearfully by. For something walks along the stair, something that is and isn't there.
This looks like it. Darling, this is the one that's 2,500.
Well, the price is ridiculous. Must be falling to bits or something. Well,
let's go and have a look while we're here.
Yeah. There's no board outside.
Yes, look. Orchard Cottage. Stop. Yes, here we are.
Wow, this can't be it. Can't buy a house like that for 2,500.
Well, you never know. Let's go and see.
Cottage. Doesn't seem to fit. I think we come to the wrong place. There must be another Orchard Cottage. Try this one.
I'm terribly sorry. We seem to have made a mistake. We're looking for a house for sale. Orchard Cottage. We're from London, is the agents.
This is Orchard Cottage.
We thought it was emptier.
It is. I just come in sometimes.
Well, can we have a look round?
Of course. Would you like to see the kitchen first?
Thank you. What a lovely big kitchen. What did they cook by, gas?
No. There was no gas. Everything was done by electricity.
Oh, it's wonderful, isn't it, Alan?
Yes. What's out there?
Larder, the washroom. Living room's this way.
Room. There must be some mistake. It's fantastic.
Yes. Let's have a look at the paper again. There you are. It says 2,500.
Can we see upstairs?
Yes. You don't mind if I don't come with you?
Oh, no. We can find a way.
You'll find the lights work. The electricity's still on.
Thank you.
What do you make of that morning?
Caretaker?
Oh, caretaker? Just take a look at this dust. It hasn't been disturbed for years.
Well?
I don't get it. The price is absurd. The Twakers have gone. This place must be worth at least 6,000. Must be some big snag that we don't know about.
It'll have to be a hell of a big snag to put me off, darling. It's a dream house.
All right, come on, let's see what we can find out from her. We've been upstairs. It's wonderful, exactly what we've been looking for. There's just one thing, though. Do you know they're selling this place for 2,500? I mean, that's ridiculous unless there's some catch in it. The place doesn't flood out or anything, does it?
No, it's high ground. There's no question of that.
Well, it must be something. I mean, people don't usually give places away. There's no aerodrome nearby or atom plant rocket launching site?
Not that I know of.
Well, why has the place been empty for so long?
I don't know. Many people have looked at it, but no one's taken it.
Oh, darling, why worry? Perhaps it's just our luck. We found the perfect house. Let's just grab it.
Suppose it could be no one's taken it because of the ghost.
Ghosts?
Why, is there one?
Didn't they tell you at the agents?
Fascinating. All this and ghosts, too.
You don't believe in them, then?
Well, I'm afraid we don't.
Oh, we'd like to hear about it. Won't you tell us?
If you like.
Oh, yes, we should be interested if we're not keeping you.
No, I've plenty of time. First, I must tell you a little about the house itself. It was originally a farmhouse. Some years ago, it was bought by a man named Mark Lemming, an electrical engineer. He converted it to what it is now. He'd recently married and he brought his wife to live here. A younger man, a friend of the husband's, was a frequent visitor. So frequent, in fact, that he more or less lived here with them. There was gossip in the village that he and the wife were a bit more than friendly. No one was surprised when they disappeared. People thought they'd run away together. Mark Lemming lived on here by himself. Most of the time he spent experimenting in the workshop he'd built out at the back. He kept very much to himself, had very few visitors. One day, about 6 months after his wife disappeared,
oh, Mr. Hazard.
Huh? What's up?
I don't suppose it's anything, but Mr. Lemming hasn't taken his milk for 3 days.
Oh?
Maybe he's sick or something.
Hmm. Mr. Lemming! Go and try the front door.
Mr. Lemming? Mr. Lemming? Are you all right, Mr. Lemming? There's no reply. There's a light burning in the hall, though, and there's a dog barking.
Mr. Lemming? Mr. Lemming? Is anyone up there? Is the constable here, sir?
Out the back, I think.
Dead 3 days. Electrocuted.
You mean he committed suicide?
Who can say? The coroner's verdict was accidental death.
How terrible. Where does the ghost come in?
I'm coming to that. A distant relative inherited the house, sold up the furniture and all the electrical gear, put the house up for sale. Then one day, a young couple came along. Very much like you two. Fell in love with it and bought it. They redecorated it and moved in. At first, all went well. They were very happy. Then, things began to happen. Harry. Harry.
Hmm?
It's done it again.
Oh, no, I don't believe it.
You better try the bulb, I think.
Yes. That's all right. Now look at the fuse box.
Mm.
We'll get the torch, will you, darling?
Oh, all right.
No, there's nothing wrong with the fuses.
What about this box here?
That's the main fuse box. If that went wrong, all the lights in the house would go out. There must be something to do with the wiring in that room. Just have to watch the television in the bedroom this evening.
Well, look at that. They're working again.
And it beats me. There must be some fault in the wiring in the wall. We'll get a man over in the morning to look at it.
I don't know. There's nothing the matter here.
Well, there must be something wrong.
I've checked the connections to the plugs and the wall sockets. I've had out the switches and all the lamp holders. They're all right. Frankly, short of tearing all the wiring out the wall, there's nothing else I can do.
Well, if we don't find out the trouble, that's exactly what we will have to do.
Make a hell of a mess of your nice new decorations.
So, no. Let's hope it's all right now.
Well, I'm just going to make some coffee. Would you like some?
Oh, thank you. I wouldn't say no, ma'am.
After that, they had no more trouble with the lights. And they thought that the fault, whatever it was, had cured itself. But had it. Harry.
Oh, no, not again. Get the torch, darling. I think I found something. Look now.
No, it's not working.
Well, try wiggling the switch about. Jim, what happened? What's the matter? Darling, what happened? What's wrong?
There's a man. There's a man over there by the window.
There's nobody there, darling. Don't be frightened. Tell me what happened.
Well, he was there. Well, I came into the room and it was dark. I jiggled the lamp switch like you said I was to, and suddenly the lamp came on right in my face. Well, I was dazzled for a second, and I saw this man standing over there by the window. First, I couldn't believe my eyes, and then he held out his hand and he started to come towards me, and then the lamp went out, and I don't know what I did.
Danny, where was he exactly?
Over by the window.
He didn't go out the window. If he'd come out of the door, I would have seen him. There's nowhere in the room for him to hide. These windows are closed and locked from the inside. Darling, are you sure you saw this man? It wasn't just some
I promise you I saw him. I saw him as clearly as I see you now. Well, I mean, I could describe him minutely. Harry, he must be in the house. He must have got out of this room before you came out of the kitchen.
But, darling, you would have seen him.
But I wouldn't, because when the lamp went out, I couldn't see anything. You must call the police.
What are you going to tell them?
Oh, tell them there's a strange man in the house, that's all.
If there's a strange man in the house, I'll find him.
Well, you're not to leave me, not for a second.
Well, what do you want me to do?
I want you to call the police.
All right, then.
What? No, I can't hear you. What? Use it, Tom. Ma!
What are you doing here at this time of night anyway? Go on, get to bed, all of you. Go on. Now what? Yes, he's here. Well, it's for you.
Hello? Yes? Oh, right away. I gotta go out again, drat it. Orchard Cottage. Burglars, I think.
Oh, do they? Well, don't you get mixed up with no burglars. They're nasty, dangerous people. If you take your time, maybe when you get there, they'll be gone.
Right, Maggie. Well, there's nobody hiding in the house, ma'am. But if you're quite sure you saw someone, I'll telephone Barnstable and have a CID man come out tomorrow morning. Now, if you'll allow me, I'd just like to take a few particulars.
Oh, yes, of course.
The next morning, the police made a thorough examination of the garden. But there were no traces that anyone had got into the house. You think I imagined it, don't you?
No, of course not, darling.
Yes, you do. You think I'm a silly, hysterical woman.
No, don't be stupid, darling.
Yes, you do. Well, I know I saw that man. I saw him as clearly as I see you now. And no one's going to talk me out of it. What about that lamp that keeps going out? You can't say that's natural. Oh, I don't know, there's something funny about this house. I felt it right from the beginning.
You're not trying to tell me you don't like the house now.
Well, I don't know.
Come on, don't be ridiculous, darling. I tell you what I do think. I think that what you thought was a man was some strange reflection you saw when you were blinded by the light coming on for a moment.
Okay.
And as for the light, well, if it happens again, we'll have the whole room rewired. If that doesn't work, then maybe we'll talk about leaving then.
Right.
Do you have to go on watching this stuff?
Thought you wanted to watch it.
Well, I thought you wanted to.
No. Well, switch it off. Harry!
What?
Harry, that's the man I saw.
What man?
The man I saw in this room, the man I saw in the window.
Oh, do stop, darling.
Oh, look, Harry! You can ring up and find out who it is.
All right, if it makes you feel any better, I will. Pass me the TV television. Hello, could I speak to someone connected with the program going out now, please?
Oh, Mr. Scott, there's a call for you. I've had it put through there. I think it's a complaint.
What, already?
Don't look at me. I didn't write the script.
Hello? Yes? There must be some mistake. There was no close-up of a... Well, of course I'm sure. You must have switched to the BBC or something. Well, I'm sorry, but there was no such close-up as you described.
All right, thank you. Goodbye.
Well, who was it?
He says there's no such man on the programme at all.
But we both saw
him. Yes, I know. He says we might have been switched over to the BBC for a moment. Some fault in the set.
Well, what were they showing?
That's an idea. It's a cartoon programme.
Well, at least you can't say it was my imagination this time.
Well, there's nothing wrong with the set, whatever. There's only one possible explanation for this. Sometimes there are freak receptions. Pictures are being picked up from America, even. No one quite knows why. Well, it's something to do with cosmic radiation and reflections from the heaviside layer.
Sure, if that were the case, wouldn't other houses in the immediate neighborhood have picked it up as well?
With a similar set and arrow,
yeah. Yeah, I thought of that myself. This morning I rang up all the houses in the vicinity. There aren't many, but several of them had sets identical to mine. Now, not one of them had seen the picture of the man or had the program interrupted in any shape or form.
Well, I don't understand it, sir. There's nothing wrong with our set. Shall I put it back?
I suppose you'd better.
After that, as you can imagine, both Mrs. Trevor and her husband were really shaken. She wanted to leave the house at once. But since they'd spent so much money on it, he wasn't keen to give it up. I think at the back of his mind, he felt that someone was playing a trick on them to get rid of them for some reason or other. So, as a last resort, they decided to call in a psychic investigator.
You mean a ghost hunter?
Sort of, yes.
The reason I find this case so fascinating is the television angle. I've always regarded the television screen as the obvious medium for extrasensory communication, and there it actually happened. I can't tell you how grateful I am to you both for letting me in on it.
I'm afraid I can't share your enthusiasm. The whole thing has created absolute chaos. My wife has been scared stiff, the story's got out of the village, and the Daily Help has quit. Personally, I don't believe in ghosts or supernatural manifestation, whatever it is. Anyway, what on earth do you mean by extrasensory perception?
Yeah, it's perfectly simple. The normal sensory perceptions are those we receive through the eyes, the ears, and the senses of touch and smell. Any perceptions we receive outside these are called extrasensory. You've almost certainly experienced some yourself.
I'm quite sure I haven't.
What about dreams? Don't you ever dream?
Yes, of course I do.
Well, there you are, then. You see things in dreams just as vividly as you do in waking hours. But your eyes are closed. You see things, but not through your eyes. Am I right?
Presumably.
Has anybody ever punched you on the nose? It's all right, I'm not going to.
Charming.
I'm asking a question. Have you ever been punched on the nose?
Well, I used to box when I was in the army.
And did you see stars?
Frequently.
And do you believe that actual stars physically developed in front of your eyes?
No, of course not.
But you saw them, didn't you? When in point of fact they weren't there at all. Good.
Please go on, Mr. Burton. I'm most interested.
Thank you, Mrs. Trevor. You will see where I'm getting in a minute. Do you know what an encephalograph is?
No, I'm afraid I don't.
Well, it's a delicate machine for measuring thought impulses emitted from the brain.
You mean the lie detector?
Well, that's a simple adaptation of the machine. The principle of it is this. Electrodes are connected to different parts of the brain.
You mean they have to make holes in people's heads?
No, not with this machine.
Oh, do shut up, darling.
Now, if it's possible to measure electric impulses going out of the brain, generated by certain emotions, will you not accept the fact that the system can be reversed and that certain electric impulses can be put into the brain, causing corresponding emotions?
Yes, but we haven't got an NCO, what's its?
Encephalograph. But in this case, you don't have to have one. These are outside currents. These currents are here, amongst us, around us, all the time. Listen, you've accepted the fact that an electric impulse from the brain under emotion can be measured. Well, after all, the machine has proved that, hasn't it? Now look, what happens when you throw a pebble into a pond?
It's wet.
Good for you. And the water?
Ripples?
Exactly. And those ripples go on until they get to the edge of the pond, don't they?
Yes, presumably.
But supposing there's no edge of the pond? Supposing it just goes on forever? What happens to the ripples then?
They would go on forever as well.
Precisely. So we have reached a point where I think we agree that an electric impulse emitted from the brain under emotion will create a wave that'll go on forever.
Yes.
And the stronger the emotion, the stronger the waveform.
Mm-hmm.
So, if we have a receiver sufficiently sensitive, we can pick up these waves or vibrations and convert them back into corresponding emotions.
Yes, but we haven't got one. A receiver, I mean.
That's where you're so wrong. We have. You are one of those instruments. And so are you, too, particularly, Mrs. Trevor. I've shown you how the brain can pick up extrasensory perceptions. Now, that's precisely what you two have been doing. The lights, the man, the image on the TV have all been extrasensory perceptions caused by the vibrations existing in this room.
But why only in this room?
Because it was in this room that the original violent emotion causing those vibrations took place. The ceiling, the walls, all are in tune with them.
Oh, how awful.
I think it's a lot of nonsense.
I'm sorry. Well, then, I shall just have to give you visual proof, that's all. The business of this light going out, when does it happen?
Well, we never really know. About 9 o'clock, but not every night.
Hmm. Yeah, I should like to have seen that. I can't stay. I've got some other inquiries to make. Look, I wonder if you'd do something for me, would you? Excuse me a moment. Thank you. Now, you see this? I want you to leave it exactly as it is now. And when the light goes out, I want you to lift this lever. You see that lever there?
Mm-hmm.
Just lift it up. But be sure that the light is out before you touch the lever. And then telephone me, would you? Let me see.
What is it?
Hmm?
This thing, what is it?
Oh, it's a recording camera.
Camera? What are you expecting it to photograph?
I really wouldn't know.
You think he'll come back, don't you? You expect it to photograph that man?
No, we shall just have to wait and see, won't we?
It's after nine. Nothing's happened.
Ooh, it's getting cold in here. Beginning to wish we hadn't started all this.
It was your idea to get that character down here. Personally, I think we need our heads examined.
Hurry!
What's his number?
Oh, it's Perivale 193.
Now, I've got the proof I spoke about, but I don't think you're going to like it. That camera I left you with had a ultra-sensitive film, and these are the photographs it took. You are absolutely certain that the light was out before you set it going?
Yes, of course.
Well, then take a look at this. You see? The negative is fully exposed. And the filaments of the lamp are burning brightly.
Well, I'm positive that that lamp was off when that photograph was taken.
Well, let's hope it'll be off again tonight. This is one final test I want to make. Can you by any chance lay your hands on an oil lamp of any sort?
Yes, we've got one in the garage.
Good. It seems to be all right. Now, this one. This meter shows the current flowing through the light. When the light's on, as it is now, the needle is deflected. When the light's off, the needle returns to zero. Now all we have to do is to wait.
How many do you want?
Yeah, sorry, three.
Three.
Dealer takes three. Right.
Oh, I'm sorry, no way.
Better penny.
Come over here. The light's out, but the current's still flowing. The needle's deflected. Now, it's on again, and there is no variation in the reading. The force of the vibrations has only power to affect the electric lamp, not the oil lamp, which remained alight. And that, Mr. Trevor, is the visual proof that I promised you. That lamp does not go out. It only appears to do so to us in this room. Now, the former owner of this house, the scientist who was electrocuted 3 years ago, was a man obsessed by electronics. All his thoughts, all his energies were directed towards things electrical. And at the time of his death, he was engaged on experiments for inducing artificial visual sensations straight into the brain without the use of the eyes.
But what has all this to do with the lamp going out?
Well, my theory about that is this. The vibrations in this room, which created in us the phenomena of the light going out, and for you too, the image of the man on the TV screen, was originally generated in that man's brain. Now, in order to put that theory to the test, I want to hold a seance in here with a medium, just to try and discover something more about the circumstances of that man's death.
No, I'd rather you didn't. There are some things I think we'd better not know.
Recognize that man?
It's the man on the TV screen.
Exactly. It's a photograph of Mark Lemming, the scientist who was electrocuted in this house. Now, do you see why we have to have this seance? It's pretty around here, isn't it?
Oh, yes, it's lovely.
Delightful. Oh, hello. Well, you see, I managed to persuade Mrs. Bucknell to come.
So I see. You better come in.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, Mrs. Trevor. May I introduce Mrs. Bucknell, Mr. and Mrs. Trevor?
How do you do?
How do you do?
How do you do?
How do you do?
Would you like to come upstairs and take your coat off?
Oh, thank you. I should like that. What a very pretty house you have, my dear. It must be so lovely to have a garden. I have always wanted a garden. We live in Glasgow.
May I get the room ready now?
Yes, of course. Yeah.
Hmm.
I say, old man, you can't be serious about that woman.
What do you mean?
Well, she's not my idea of a medium.
What is your idea of a medium? Someone who wears a pointed hat and arrives on a broomstick?
No, don't be ridiculous.
You know, the only thing that makes a medium different is that by some freak accident of nature, they're supersensitive to vibrations which are beyond the normal range of people. It's an entirely a physical attribute. Like exceptional eyesight, ultra-acute hearing. And you know, she's probably one of the most sensitive mediums in the world. We're very lucky she agreed to come along. Would you draw those curtains for me?
Do we really have to do that? I mean, why does it have to be in the dark?
It doesn't. But in a subdued light, the medium's thoughts are less distracted. Ah, there we are.
Who is that man over there? That man by the curtains.
There's nobody there, Mrs. Bucknell. Only the four of us.
I thought I saw a man. I don't like this room, Mr. Burton. I don't want to go on. I had a feeling I should never have come, and now I'm sure.
You wouldn't let us down, would you, Mrs. Bucknell? So much depends on this seance. You will help us, won't you?
Very well. But only as a favor to you, Mr. Burton.
Thank you. Come on.
Shall I sit there?
Yes, if you would. Some of these cushions by
you. Oh, thank you.
Yes. They're quite comfy.
Yes, thank you.
Right. Are you ready, Mrs. Bucknell?
Yes, quite ready, Mr. Burton.
Whatever you hear, keep absolutely still. Any sudden noise or movement could be dangerous to the medium.
I am in a room, a sort of workshop. There are machines and instruments. I do not understand. There is a man.
Sally? Sally? Mookies? Mookies? Come, Mookies, Sally.
Something.
works. It works. My theory is right. In a few days, I shall be ready for your help. Sally, you may not know it, but one of these days, you'll be more famous than Rin Tin Tin.
He thinks I'm going to get mixed up in his horrible experiments. He's got another thing coming. Clive, what are we going to do?
I like that. You're asking me when I've been imploring you for months to come away with me.
And what would we use for money?
I could soon get a regular job.
I suppose you could. I suppose I could cook and darn your socks and do the weekly wash. No, darling, I'm afraid it wouldn't work. Mark's a rich man. You know that, don't you? That last accident he had, when he nearly electrocuted himself, damaged his heart. Another shock, even a minor one, would kill him. Would you love me any less if I were a wealthy widow?
We might have to wait for years.
Yes, but I'm not going to wait. Mark must have another accident, a fatal one. I've thought out how it can be arranged. If you love me enough to help me.
You mean that we should kill him?
What else do you think it means? There is no other way. You must see that.
We'd never get away with it.
We could, you know. I think I found a way. Does anything occur to you?
No, should it?
Haven't you ever heard of people electrocuting themselves in baths by touching the electric fire?
Yes, but I've never known why.
It happens when there's a leak to Earth.
Do you know what that means? I don't.
No, but we could find out.
So that we could fix the fire so that there is a leak?
Why not?
Even if we did, how are we going to get Mark to be so obliging as to stand in the bath and grab hold of the fire?
We don't have to. Look, Mark reads in the bath, sometimes for hours. When it gets cold, he switches on the fire by reaching up and pulling this cord. Now, if we could make this knob alive...
Look, I'm pretty dim where electricity is concerned, but the police aren't. They'd spot it at once.
No, they wouldn't. Not if we put it all back as it was before. They just think he had a heart attack. They know he's got a weak heart.
Suppose we did do it. How are we going to find out the way to change the wires?
Yes. Yes, that's the only problem, isn't it?
Well, it's quite simple. You, pull this cord here.
You know, I know absolutely nothing about electricity. I've read so many times about people being electrocuted, it's always put me off having a fire in the bathroom.
Well, there's no need to worry about that with this fire, madam.
I expect that's what the people thought who were electrocuted.
How is it there have been so many fatal accidents with fires in bathrooms?
Well, because the equipment has been faulty and there's been a leak to earth.
What is a leak to earth?
Well, it's when one side of the current touches the frame of the fire.
What?
Well, let me try and show you. Now, here we have a standard three-pin plug.
Hello, yes, Lemming here. Oh, yes, of course. Good, good, that's excellent. Well, I come up this afternoon and bring my latest notes with me. Splendid.
What's he playing at?
Mark, give us back our shoes. Oh, all right, you've had your joke. I don't think it's very funny.
I'm sorry you didn't like it.
Please give them back.
Oh, I can't do that yet. It's only the first part of the joke.
Look, Mark, I'm not in the mood for any nonsense. Give us back our shoes. Clive, will you go and get some others? You know where I keep mine.
Yes, of course. Oh, just a minute, Clive. You may very well know where my wife keeps her shoes, but I wouldn't touch that door handle if I were you.
Oh, and why not?
Because it might be the last thing you ever touched.
What's the matter with you? Have you gone out of your mind?
Oh, I don't think so. If you were to touch that handle, the same thing might happen to you as would have happened to me. If I'd switched on the bathroom fire.
What on earth are you talking about?
Only about the little joke that you prepared for me.
Look, I don't know what all this is about, but whatever it is, I don't think it's funny.
Oh, don't you, Clive? I do. I think it's very funny. Because the laugh would certainly have been on you. You don't suppose for a moment that Stella would have stuck to you once she'd got the money, do you?
Will you please tell us what all this is about?
Oh, why bother to keep it up? You're wasting your time, both of you. Listen.
But I'm not going to wait. Mark must have another accident, a fatal one. I've thought out how it can be arranged.
I don't think we need to hear any more, do we? I was wondering how you proposed to do it. It was most ingenious. It was only the merest fluke that it didn't come off. The telephone rang at the essential moment. You might say I was saved by the bell.
All right, so you know. What are you going to do about it?
Well, I could hand you over to the police.
And the evidence? That proves nothing.
No, you're quite right. It doesn't. Anyway, I never seriously thought of the police. I think this is something that we should settle between the three of us, don't you, Clive?
Yes, I do. Look, Stella and I will clear out and you'll never see us again.
Oh, come now. That's hardly fair. After all, you did try to kill me. I think I'm entitled to some compensation.
What do you mean by that?
Well, I think I ought to be allowed to have a go at you two. Now, don't look so alarmed, Clive. It's just a little game I've arranged.
A game?
Yes, a game. Getting you to take your shoes off was a part of it. A very essential part.
Go on.
Well, you see, just before I came in here, I switched on a high-voltage generator in my workshop. One lead from which, the positive, is led to this carpet. The other lead, the negative, is connected to various objects and fittings in this room, such as the door handles. Now, if you should be standing on the carpet and happen to touch one of these objects, you'll get a shock that will undoubtedly kill you. That's why I had to get your shoes off.
You can't frighten me. The carpet's not a conductor of electricity.
Normally, no. But you'll find this one is. You see, I've sprayed it all over with a solution of sal ammoniac that makes it a very good conductor. Whether you believe me or not, you'll soon find out. And since you're so knowledgeable about electricity, my dear, don't be tempted into thinking you can insulate yourself by standing on the cushions or wrapping the curtains around your feet, because I've sprayed them too. I even had a chance to have a go at your clothes. So you should find my game very interesting. And don't be fooled by this. I have on thick rubber soles.
You don't believe all that nonsense, do you? He's bluffing.
Oh, don't be a fool. Let's test it first.
But how?
I know. This.
Well, supposing it is alive.
Oh, it'll be all right if I keep this end on the ground. Thank God I stopped you. He's insane. He must be.
What are we going to do?
There isn't anything we can do. We'll just have to stay here until Mrs. Lee comes in the morning.
She won't come. She started her holiday yesterday. Nobody will come for 2 weeks.
Well, somebody's bound to turn up. A tradesman or...
The phone. He's forgotten the phone. We're all right.
No! Don't touch it. It may be alive. Wait a minute.
Thank God it's safe.
Hello. How are you getting on? It's quite a problem, isn't it? Never mind. I thought I'd just let you know that this game has a time limit. If you're not out of this room by midnight tonight, I'm afraid you'll have had it anyway.
The dialing tone. The dialing tone. He's forgotten to switch over. Get on to someone before he comes back.
What's the police number?
Dial 100 and ask for the police. Ah! Oh, no!
Under the workshop floor.
Get some brandy, would you? Thank you. Open those curtains, please.
It's so strange. Did it go off all right? Was it a successful seance?
No.
Oh. Do you know, I would like a cup of tea.
My God, what a terrible story. But how do you know all this?
What happened in the end? Did they look under the shed?
Oh, yes. They dug up under the shed.
Well, did they find anything?
Yes. They found the body of Clive Mayhew.
But the woman, did they find her body too?
No. Her body was never found. Some people say she's walled up somewhere in this house.
What's the matter with the lights?
It's like I said. The lights do go up and down. You see, this is the room.
The dead man's gone, dressed in a top hat. close the door.
This thing's made of solid steel.
A young girl was killed here. And whatever got her wasn't human.
Don't stand there.
What do you
mean? Where?
Too late, they've marked you.
Ridiculous. The roof probably leaks.
Oh, that must be what it is.
To be driving. Oh man, what I'd give to be back at home, snug and warm. Wait a minute, what's that up ahead? Ah, gas station. Pardon me, is this the way to Elm Hall Plantation?
Yes. Yes, it is, but no one's there. I'd advise you to turn back. It's not safe in this weather.
Thanks. Into situations like this anyway. Who would have thought a week ago I'd be here driving on a lonely, dark road looking for an old mansion? What can you do? Last week I received that letter informing me that I had inherited an antebellum mansion just 20 miles outside of Natchez, Mississippi. It was left to me by my great-grandmother who lived there all of her 90 years. Boy, that's a long time. Let's see. The mansion was built, I think, in 1820. And according to the stories I've heard, it has a very mysterious and tragic history. I believe one of my ancestors, as a small child, fell to his death from a high window in the old place. It was very mysterious, as the story goes. As I recall, the window from which he fell was never closed following the accident. That's kind of weird. Anyway, the child's mother never recovered from the loss, nor did she ever leave the house again. Years later, she passed away. Her mind, that of a little girl, ever since the night of the accident. I've heard that she only walked at night, clad in a gossamer white gown, breathing the only word she ever said for the rest of her life. My baby. Have you seen my baby? Oh, I talk about creepy. Legend has it that on stormy nights like this, oh, they don't get any stormier, a white ghost-like form glides down the long corridors of Elm Hall. And it's even been said that some have sworn to have heard a cold, whispering, childlike voice saying, "My baby, have you seen my baby?" Ah, that's silly. Things like that only happen in the movies. And yet, legend also has it that those who have heard the voice have died tragically within the next year. Yeah, it's funny how these stories get started and are passed down from generation to generation. Yet, the eldest son of each generation at Elm Hall has always died mysteriously before his 25th year. Wait a minute. I won't be 25 until next week. Hey, better be careful, old boy. Oh, boy, this storm looks like it'll never let up. And the lightning. Whew. Huh. I wonder what it was like in the old days. Plenty of servants, I bet. Horses, carriages, and those... Oh, those beautiful southern bells. Ah, yes, riding off to war with Beauregard. My old Elm Hall was certainly a pride of the old South. I bet it's a wreck today. My luck. I seem to remember another story about the old place. What was that? Oh, yeah, something about one of the daughters who was exceptionally beautiful. In fact, wait a minute. I remember an old photograph I once saw of her. And she was beautiful, even in that old-timey picture. Let's see, I think it was during the Civil War. That's it. Her name was Elizabeth, and she fell in love with a Yankee lieutenant. When her father found out, he went into a wild rage and told her she couldn't see the young lieutenant again. For weeks, she just stayed in her room. And then one day news came. Her lieutenant had been killed in the war. That afternoon, she rode her favorite horse. Oh, wow, what was his name? Dancer. That's right, Dancer. She rode Dancer down to the Mississippi. And her horse returned home to Elm Hall that night, riderless. As I remember the story, about a week later, some young boys fishing on a sandbar saw her float by. Her body was returned to Elm Hall, and she was buried in the family cemetery on the grounds of the plantation. They say that on summer evenings, when it's deathly still, some people can hear a rush of wind like a rider passing by. And the Spanish moss hanging from the old tree in front parts like someone has just passed through. Oh, boy, that's creepy. Some say it's Elizabeth looking for her lover. And yet, others say it's her favorite horse, Dancer, looking for her. For every day, for the rest of his life, her horse would walk riderless to the Mississippi and wait patiently until nightfall for Elizabeth to return. And then he would walk back slowly in his grief to Elm Hall. Wait a minute, there's something up ahead. That's it. Yeah, that's the old place. That's Elm Hall. Well, don't just sit in the car, Stephen. Go in and have a look around. Window upstairs. It's open, and the curtain is flapping wildly. Look at that. There seems to be a light on up there. No. Come on, there's no light on up there. Stephen, you're imagining things. Oh, boy, it's still creepy. Front door is open. Good. It's not locked. Glad I brought this flashlight. Hope it doesn't conk out on me. Oh, wow. What a beautiful place. It is kind of eerie, though. This must be the living room. Wait a minute. No. It's the front parlor. That's what they called it. Look at those drapes. Oh. Oh, great. All that dust. I'll never get it out of my nose. Wait a minute. Look at that marble fireplace. It must be worth a fortune. What's that? There seems to be a portrait over the fireplace. It's Elizabeth. It has to be Elizabeth, the girl who lost her lover in the Civil War. Oh, boy, is she beautiful. It's almost like going back in time. Wait a minute, there's a pipe organ over there. That's got to be worth a fortune. And look at that, another portrait. Let's see, it looks like a Confederate general. I wonder who he is. Oh my, holy cow. His eyes moved. No, they couldn't have. They didn't move. They couldn't have moved. I could have sworn his eyes moved. His eyes look real. All right, now stop. Stephen, get a hold of yourself, boy. Now, come on. It's only a picture. The eyes didn't move. Even though it looked like they did. All right, let's go in the hallway. Come on. Oh, darn. There goes the flashlight. What a time to go out. What's that? Is that the wind? No, it's footsteps. Oh, no. Oh, no, don't let this be happening to me. It's just my imagination. Oh, no, they're coming nearer.
They're coming nearer. Oh, my heart is pounding. Stop. I gotta stop my heart from pounding, because they're gonna hear me. Stop. Oh, I can't. They're going past me. They must have seen me. They must have seen me. They must know I'm here. I can't see anything. It's so dark. No one could be playing the organ. I'm the only one here. Wait a minute. There's a light or something down at the end of the hall. Wait. Wait a minute. It's somebody. It's somebody coming down here. It looks like a woman. I think she's wearing a white gown. She's coming this way. She's looking right at me. But wait a minute. She's looking right at me, but she doesn't even see me. Oh, no. She just floated right through the wall. It's like a dream. That's it. It's a dream. It's a dream. It's just a dream, Stephen. Oh, my heart's about to explode. Good Lord! What's that? Oh, it's right here. It just missed me. It feels like a coffin. No, no, it can't be a coffin. Oh, don't let it be a coffin. Wait a minute. I think it's a grandfather's clock. Please let it be a grandfather's clock, please. What's that? Oh, no. Not bats. Bats. I can't stand bats. Get away. Get away from me. They're in my hair. Get. I can't take this any longer. I'm getting out of here while I still can. Where's the front door? It's this way. No, wait a minute. I think it's this way. Oh, wait a minute. Wait, stop. Stop. You got to think straight now. Now, stop. Where are you? You took a left. You took a right? Get me out of here. Get me out of here. Wait a minute. It's the door. It's the door. It won't open. It won't open. It's got to open. Open up. Open up. Door, please open. Please, door, open. I'm trapped. Oh, thank heavens. It opened. Wait, what's that? A horse. I'm getting out of here before I go mad. Oh, no. The car won't start. Darn it, start. Wait. Stop. Stop for a second. It'll start. Just turn the key too hard, that's all. Just turn it easy and... Oh, yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Corp. Thank you. I'll never go near that place again. That's it. I've got to unload that place. I don't care what I get for it. I've got to unload it. I'll take anything. Is this the right road? Oh, it's got to be. I hope I'm heading towards town. I must be getting near that town by now. Yeah, there's the gas station. Oh, good.
Y'all went up the old place after all, huh?
Oh, yeah. Look, could you tell me where I can spend the night? A hotel, a motel?
Hotel, now, let's see. The Jeb Stuart Hotel is a right nice place, and that's just down the street away.
Yeah, I saw that place when I came into town. Look, is there any place else?
No. That is the only place in town. But I'll tell you, it's the finest hotel we have in these parts. I know, because I own it.
Oh, boy. One other thing. Is there a real estate firm here in town?
Yeah, well, now you all be talking about the Dixon Company.
Dixon Company?
Yeah, huh? And it's the only place in town.
Yeah, I figured as much.
And I own that, too.
Midnight, my favorite time, the witching hour. And the dark gives me such comfort. Thank you. Now, let's see, where was I? Oh, yes, the clock reminded me of something very important. John Bellairs built an entire story around that lovely ticking sound. The house with a clock in its walls. Oh, the way these authors can think of to scare us. Tick, tick, tick. It's a most enjoyable sound. That is, of course, unless the ticking comes from a clock with rather a deadly nature. Such a clock existed in the house of Jonathan Barnabelt. Now, this clock was... This... All right, now that's enough! This clock was actually to threaten the very lives of old Jonathan and his young nephew, Lewis, and everyone else on this planet. Now, Lewis, poor lad, had lost both of his parents in an auto crash, and there was nowhere else in the entire world that he could live except with old Jonathan. Lewis was about to begin an adventure like no other in his life. He was to live in Jonathan's peculiar old house, and he was to come face to face with that ghost who was searching for that cursed clock.
Well, Lewis, this is going to be your room. Now, you must be tired after your long journey. I think you should go right to bed.
But, Uncle Jonathan, it's early.
We go to bed early around here, boy.
What are we going to do tomorrow, Uncle Jonathan?
You'll see. I have things planned. Things. Good night. Good night.
Come in.
Suddenly, Lewis sat up, wide awake. What was that knocking? He tiptoed to the door as carefully as he could. He was frightened, but he was also curious. A horrible thought came into his mind. Was Jonathan crazy? His parents had always warned him about crazy people. Lewis followed Uncle Jonathan all the way downstairs to the library. His Uncle Jonathan was certainly a strange person. Why did he keep knocking on the walls? What was he looking for?
Yuck. I hope this isn't a distant relative. Yikes! A secret panel. Curses, Volume 6, by Jonathan Barnabelt, Wizard First Degree. Holy smokes! Uncle Jonathan's a wizard!
Now Uncle Jonathan was climbing up into the dark attic. What was going on in this strange old house? Lewis's curiosity made him follow.
Where'd he go? An organ. This is great. Yipes! Well, Jonathan's gonna kill me for breaking this old thing. What's this? Doomsday? And who is Isaac Izzard?
A witch.
Ah!
Lewis, you have a lot to learn about sneaking around.
Isaac Izzard was a witch, so he hid the doomsday plan in the old organ.
I thought I'd looked everywhere in this old house. It used to be his house, you know.
What is the doomsday plan, Uncle Jonathan?
It's a plan to destroy the world, of course. He's got the whole world wired up. The clock, boy. The clock in the wall. Old Izzard hid the clock in the wall so he could come back and blow the planet right off the map.
Come back? From where?
From the dead, boy. Where else? You see, he died before he could set the alarm, and it won't go off until he does. I hope. I was hoping that this parchment would lead us to where he hid the blasted thing, but it doesn't. Just like old Izzard, he is trying to drive me crazy. You saw me stopping the clocks. I do it every night, so I can hear old Izzard's clock ticking. Listen.
I can hear it.
Of course you can. You can hear it all night long. That's why I've got so many clocks of my own. I'd rather hear them than that old ticker of Izzard's. I only stop them at night when I go to look for his.
Why don't you just tear down the walls and get it?
Oh, I could. I could. I could tear down the whole house and set it off by accident. The ticking seems to come from everywhere, in the attic, in the cellar, in the closet, and then it seems just to be moving around to rattle my brains. But I'll find it. It had just better be before old Izzard comes to pay us a visit.
Us, Uncle Jonathan?
Well, you're part of the family, aren't you?
Yes, sir.
Well, then you can help me hunt for the clock.
Uncle Jonathan, I got a question about the books or stuff in the secret panel. I peeked.
Yes, I know.
Well, they say you're a wizard.
Well, I am, as a matter of fact. I was going to show you those books and things before long anyhow. And my crystal ball. And here, my hand of glory. When the candle is lit, I can stun anyone so they can't move, if they so much as look at it. So you'd better behave.
You're just teasing me, aren't you, Uncle Jonathan? Although you really had me going there for a second with the witches and the crystal ball and the hand of glory and the doomsday clock.
Yes, Lewis, would you fetch me that tobacco barrel up there?
I can't reach it.
Abba, baby, Bachabi!
Uncle Jonathan, what's happening? This is fantastic! I'm flying! You are a wizard! You are!
Well, boy, I never met a wizard who lied.
Maybe I am going to be a wizard too, Uncle Jonathan.
Well, we'll see about that.
How do you do this? This is terrific! That was great, Uncle Jonathan. And then we'll find that doomsday clock. You and me. After all, I am part of the family. Hello, Tarby. What you doing?
What's it look like, Florida Belt? Does it look like I'm playing checkers, huh?
I wish I could learn how to hit a baseball like you can.
Nah, you can't. It's not something you learn. It's something you gotta be born with. It's a gift, Barnabelle. And I got the gift and you don't.
You going trick-or-treating tonight?
No. Halloween's for kids.
Yeah, you're right. I guess me and my Uncle Jonathan probably just cast some spells or something. Maybe we'll eclipse the moon if we feel up to it.
You're not only little, you're loony. What do you think you are, a witch or something?
Wizard is the term, if you want to be professionally precise. Yep, we are. It runs in the family. It's a gift. You gotta be born with it.
You're a liar, Barnabelle. You're a big loony liar.
I am not, and I can prove that I'm a wizard.
Oh, yeah? Well, then do it. Just do something wizardy. I dare you.
Well, I can't. Right here, right now.
Yeah, I thought so.
Well, I mean, I can. But not until midnight. Midnight's a special time for us wizards.
Okay, then I'll meet you somewhere at midnight. Well, it being Halloween and all, you ought to just love the spooks and goblins out at the graveyard. And it's good and dark at midnight. Just us and the dead.
Yeah, that sounds okay to me, I guess.
Okay, then. At midnight at the graveyard. Well, if you're a wizard, then you can raise the dead, right?
Yeah.
This is one thing I gotta see. Wiz.
Is this some kind of showdown?
Well, look on it as an opportunity. You're a new kid in town. You gotta prove if you're hot stuff or not.
Yeah, right, midnight. I'll raise the dead.
Gee, you can't eclipse the moon. And I had to go until Darby, I could raise the dead. Let's see. Aha! Raising the dead. Let's see. Supplies. Incantations. Midnight. I'm late.
Darby! Where are you? Darby! It's me, Louis Barnabelle.
Very funny, Tarby.
I know it's you. Ah!
What kept you, Shrimp?
Tarby, that's not funny.
Well, I thought it was. Okay, now let's do what we came here to do. Follow me. I found a perfect grave. Hey, what do you think? It's a beaut, huh? Oh, and look at this. The trumpet shall sound and the dead shall be raised. Did you bring a trumpet, Hotshot?
Well, not exactly.
Okay, well, let's do it.
Gotta sit down first. Magic symbols.
I don't see any dead people.
It's not finished yet. We gotta put in the name.
So put it in.
Well, the tomb doesn't have any name written on it. Maybe if we sit here for a minute, it'll come to us. Shine the light down the center of the circle.
Where'd you get that from?
I don't know. It just popped into my head.
Now what, Wiz? Abba, Baba, Fakabib! I did it! Look at her! I did it! I am a wizard! Come on! You're nuts! Come on! uncle to help us. Are you crazy? I'm not going to your house.
What's the matter? Are you afraid of him?
No, I'm not afraid. I don't ever want to see you again. I'm going to tell my mom on you.
Uncle Jonathan! Uncle Jonathan, I just got to talk to you.
Shh! It's louder than ever.
But I just got to talk to you.
Hey, listen to that. It's been taking away a storm since just after midnight.
Uncle Jonathan, I went to the graveyard and raised the dead. I guess I bragged a bit to Tarby. And he dared me to try it. So I did. And Uncle Jonathan, I did it!
So you use my books, eh? And you raised the dead, eh?
Yes, sir.
You are part of the family. You passed the test.
Then you aren't angry?
No, you should have asked me before you got into my books and papers, but it's okay.
Listen, that clock is having fits. So go on. Tell me, what did you do?
Well, I did just what you put down in the book. But the tomb didn't have any name written on it. And the book says it's important to have the name of the person written in the circles.
Oh, you gotta have the name.
So I just sat there and thought about it. And when the name came to me, I wrote it down. S-E-L-E-N-N-A. And boom, bang, out she popped.
Selena? You wrote down Selena?
Yeah. Scariest thing I ever saw. Chased us out of the graveyard. Jonathan, what's the matter?
Selena was the name of Mrs. Izzard. That's what's got into the clock. Now that she's free, she's going to want to set off the doomsday plan.
You mean I raised Mrs. Izzard from the dead?
It looks like it, kid. We've got to find that clock before Selena does. Let's hurry. Now, there were three spots where the ticking is the loudest. This is one of them.
Why didn't Mr. Izzard play in the Doomsday Clock?
Because he hated the whole world and he wanted to come back and destroy it after he died.
Why is Mrs. Izzard looking for the clock? Didn't he tell her where he hid it?
No, they didn't talk much.
Why not?
Well, he hated her too. Not there. I thought there might be room in there for just an itty bitty clock. But no luck.
If Mr. and Mrs. Izzard hated each other so much, why is she coming back to set off the doomsday clock for him?
Well, it was theirs together. Whoever came back first would get to set it off. She's most probably absolutely delighted to deprive him of the pleasure.
They really are wicked. No love in that family.
No love, but they were brilliant and very logical.
Then there's no point in our being logical, is there?
What do you mean?
Well, if his magic was logical, it probably can't understand magic that isn't logical. Maybe we can confuse it. Let's use some magic that doesn't make any sense at all. We'll just make it up as we go along.
You mean like some crazy magic word or action would lead us to where the doomsday clock is hidden?
Right. Why don't you play a magical song on the organ?
Well, I can't play the blasted thing, but we can try.
Take me out to the ball game. Aha! I got it. Baseball games are played on diamonds, and diamonds are a suit in the deck of cards.
So what? This doesn't make any sense at all.
Good. Then we're doing it right. Okay, magical cards, do your stuff.
They're all the eight of diamonds. What does that mean?
That means that the number eight makes no sense at all. Oh, tell me, mystical eight ball.
Lewis.
Where is the clock?
Lewis, I bought that in a toy store. It only says yes, no, or maybe.
Where is the clock? Uncle Jonathan, it's in the coal bin.
Well, I'll be jiggered. It didn't make any sense, but it worked. Let's go.
There's the passage.
Stand back, boy.
The doomsday clock.
In a secret passage.
Now what?
Those must be the wires connected to all the capitals of the world.
No touch!
Why?
It might go off.
I thought you said it wasn't set yet.
Well, you have to dismantle it very carefully, like a time bomb. Now, it may not go off. On the other hand...
Thank you for doing my work, Funny. I do hope you haven't tired yourselves. Well, look at you, Jonathan. Crushed by my hand of glory. I'm surprised at you. You should know better than to stare at it. Boy! Turn around and face me! You want to kiss your land, Peter? Come now, it'll only make it worse for you in the end.
Uncle Jonathan, what do I do?
Turn around. And I'll let you watch what I do to your old fool of an uncle. Ah! And then it'll be your turn. Doomsday is here! Turn around. I command you! Turn around, I say! Stop!
You did it, boy. You saved the day. So much for logic.
Man, you know that house up at the end of the road that nobody goes near? Well, let me tell you why they don't. Well, in the haunted house at the top of the hill, the spooks give around to test their skill. That struck out 12 every night. You seem to such a frightful sight. Stay away when the ghosts and the goblins play, when the hands of the clocks pull out midnight. Better get in out of sight. Well, the ghosts and the witches and the devil too are in there mixing up a brew. And if a man should venture near, his soul inside would disappear. Your soul and mine is in their brew, the fate of which we have no clue. All we do is hope and pray we'll be here another day. Stay away when the ghosts and the goblins play, when the hands of the clocks pull out midnight. Better get in out of sight. Well, if a loose life I did lead, my soul is filled with selfish greed. Thus my soul has found this plight, the devil's judging yours tonight. Oh, brother, hear me when I say you'd better live right every day, cause someday it will be your turn, and if you don't, your soul will burn. Stay away when the ghosts and the goblins play, when the hands of the clocks pull out midnight. Better get in out of sight.
It is now 56 years since I experienced 10 minutes of the most horrible fright, that ever since then I tremble at unexpected noises and am afraid of the dark. On that fatal day, as I was walking on the street, I met a friend to whom I was deeply attached as a youth. But he seemed to have aged much more than I. His hair was quite white, and he walked with a noticeable stoop. He apparently noticed my surprise, for he told me of the misfortune which shattered his life. He fell madly in love with a young girl and married her, but after only a year, she died suddenly. He was so affected that he left his chateau and never returned. Now he asked me to do a great favor for him. There were some very important papers in his bedroom desk in the old house. So important that he would trust no one but me to go for them. He gave me the key of the room and the key to the desk, both of which were locked on the day he left the house forever. The two packages of letters and roll of papers were to be found in the first drawer on the right of the desk. Since he was less than an hour's ride on horseback, I readily agreed. The weather was glorious. I cantered over the turf, listening to the birds. I entered the forest and walked my horse. When I reached the house, I was shocked by its condition. The open gate drooped on its hinges. The walks were overgrown with grass. The house itself was badly in need of paint, and the shutters drooped sadly. I finally got the door open and entered. I climbed the creaky old stairs and recognized the door described by my friend. The room was so dark, I could distinguish nothing. My nostrils were offended by the disagreeable moldy odor. The room was in total disorder. As my eyes became accustomed to the light, I found the writing desk. I opened the proper drawer and began searching for the documents. As I searched, I seemed to hear, or rather feel, something rustle behind me. Then another slight movement sent a disagreeable chill over my skin. As I was about to pick up the third packet, I heard a long, painful sigh just over my shoulder. I leapt up like a madman and turned about. A tall woman dressed in white stood gazing at me. Such a shudder ran through my limbs that I nearly fell backward. Then she spoke. Oh, sir, can you save me, cure me? I suffer frightfully. She held out a tortoiseshell comb and murmured, please comb my hair. I suffer because my hair pulls so. I took the comb, then her long black hair. It felt as if I were handling snakes. I don't know how long I combed those icy, slimy locks. Suddenly, she snatched the comb and fled through a closet door. It was as though I had awakened from a horrible nightmare. I burst open a window and sprang to the closet door. It was closed and immovable. I had a mad desire to flee. Seizing the three packets, I dashed from the house, leapt on my horse, and galloped away. When I reached my lodgings, I shut myself into my room to reflect. I had almost convinced myself that I had been the victim of hallucination when, by chance, my eyes fell upon my chest. Around the buttons of my jacket were entwined a quantity of long, black, slimy hairs.
Do you believe in ghosts? I do. And you will, too, when you come to this theater and see my picture, 13 Ghosts. No more dictation today. When you see 13 Ghosts, you'll be given a supernatural viewer which will enable you to penetrate for the first time into the spirit world.
Ow, hey!
You believe in ghosts, Buck?
Sure.
You want some cake?
Cake? Oh, yeah, yeah. I wish we had a house with furniture that nobody could take away from us.
Cyrus Zorba, telegram for you.
So, you inherit the house, which is the bulk of the estate.
Is this all? The house and the package? No other,
Dr. Zorba must have been quite wealthy at one time. Apparently, he spent it all on his experiments. Dr. Zorba collected ghosts from all over the world. You inherit them, too. They go with the house.
Hey, look what I found. What does Ouija mean?
Why, I haven't seen one of these for years. It's a Ouija board.
Are there any ghosts in this house?
Thirteen what?
Ghosts.
Thank you.
During a stroll through the countryside, I found myself on the road above a tunnel through which the railroad tracks pass. Down below was a tiny station, which was maintained by the signalman who was standing near the great iron bars, which are the means of switching the tracks. I shouted down to him, "Hello down there!" Before he could answer, there was a vibration in the earth which quickly turned into a violent pulsation as a train roared out of the tunnel. As the train disappeared down the tracks, he folded his signal flag and beckoned me to come down. I found my way and joined him at the small building. He looked at me as if he was afraid. When I asked if anything was wrong, he said he thought he might have seen me before. When I asked where, he pointed at the red light at the mouth of the tunnel. I was quite puzzled as I followed him into the little house. Inside, there was a fire, a desk, and a telegraphic instrument, and that was all. I asked what he meant when he pointed to the red light. Instead of answering, he asked a most strange question. What made me call out, "Hello down there"? Why those exact words? When I asked why those exact words were important, he said he would tell me on our next visit. But please, he said, don't call out. The following night, I returned to the signal station and joined him inside. He told me that he had mistaken me for someone else. When I asked who, he said he didn't know for sure, because the person's left arm is always across his face as he waves violently with his right arm. Then he explained, "One moonlight night, I was sitting here when I heard a voice cry out, 'Hello down there!' I looked out of the door and saw a person standing by the red light, waving his right arm. The voice seemed quite hoarse as it cried, 'Hello down there! Look out! Look out!' I ran to the figure, but just as I got to the place where it was standing, it was gone. I stood there in amazement, listening to the eerie wind blowing through the telegraph wires above me. Within 6 hours, there was news of a horrible crash at the other end of the tunnel. That was a year ago. A few months later, I saw the figure again, and the whole sequence was repeated. Within a few hours, a train came out of the tunnel and stopped at my station. I could hear the terrible cries as the conductor told me that a passenger had just suffered a violent death on board. The figure appeared again last week, but there has been no accident. I fear that this time it will be me. I tried to talk him out of his fear, but was unable to calm him, so I left. I came back the next day to find a train stopped at the little house. I walked up to a group of men and asked what was wrong. The engineer told me that the signalman was killed this morning, cut down by the engine. He had changed the light, but somehow did not jump clear of the oncoming train. The engineer said, "I saw him and blew the whistle. When he didn't react, I waved violently with my right arm as I covered my eyes with my left so that I would not see the disaster about to take place." I had to ask, "What did you actually cry out?" Then he told me his exact words were, "Hello down there! Look out! Look out!"
Would you like to rent this house, the scene of 7 grisly murders, for your next party or gathering? Mr. Watson Pritchard is hoping that you might. This spacious 25-room mansion comes furnished with a fully stocked wine cellar for your entertainment needs. As well as a complete music room. and a swimming pool should you want to take a short dip. The house also boasts wall-to-wall creeps and hot and cold running chills in every room.
This is it, huh?
Yeah, this is the Simpson house.
Rich, I don't know. It looks kind of scary.
It'll be fun. I mean, all you've got here is an old house, a dark night, a lonely part of town. I just don't want you to let anything get you scared. Everything's gonna be all right.
Of nothing. I got you that time. It's just an old dress dummy I found in there.
Oh, yeah, very funny, Ralph. Oh, come on, Ralph.
It's the curse of the Simpsons. I'll chop off your...
Ralph, this is not a funny joke.
What joke? Are these the bulging eyes of a Joker?
A cross.
Does anyone have a cross?
You dummy, that only works on vampires.
It's phony. It's phony. It's not real.
Hi, guys. Oh, it's only bagging the demons.
Oh, it's only bagging the demons.
You were shaking so much, you looked like a bowl of jello.
The only one who wasn't chicken was Cunningham. All right, Bag, you and the demons can join the party, as usual. Let's dance.
Sure. What's a Halloween party without some demons? Ha ha!